thrilling days of yesteryear, the golden age of radio, written and narrated by John Rayburn, published by Bear Manor Media of Albany, Georgia. Chapter 1, The Way It Was. Once upon a time, there was a wonderful form of family entertainment called radio. Changing times, changing attitudes, changing technology, all blended together to signal the end of the so-called golden age of radio. While it lasted, from approximately 1926 to 1952-54, it was a magical medium providing families with a means of escape from the myriad problems confronting the nation. One of the period's most memorable series, Inner Sanctum Mysteries, was produced by a gentleman named Himan Brown. Many years later, at an old-time radio convention in Los Angeles, he paraphrased for me a reflective statement that encapsulated what made radio perfect for the times. Of all the forms of theater, radio drama commanded the most effective stage. No medium, not theater, not film, not television, had more sheer space in which to achieve the basic goal of drama, telling a story. Theater is bounded by the bare boards and the footlights and the flats, film by the white screen, and television by the comparatively tiny tube. But radio played itself out in boundless space, the listener's mind, your mind. We in radio always called it the theater of imagination. We proudly traced our lineage back to the primitive campfire and the tribal storytellers as the passers-on of legend, heroic adventure, mysteries of nature. They told their stories orally, and so did we. We did not show, we told you. We made you believe everything because it was happening before your mind's eye. The basic appeal of radio drama was that you had to listen if you wanted to follow it. It wasn't enough to merely hear it. You had to listen. The word listen implies a conscious effort to pay attention, to participate. Senses were activated, the curiosity was sparked, the imagination was fired, and the listener found himself participating. He was a collaborator. In his brain, he matched a face and a body to the voice. In his mind, he saw the action. And that was the basic difference between radio and every other visual medium. A good movie, a fine stage play, a television drama, excellent ballet, all those required an appreciative audience, but only radio called for a creative audience, a listener who really worked with the writer, the director, the actors, and technicians to give completeness to the creative process. My intention is to tell at least part of the way it was, knowing full well it can't be revived, but providing background and anecdotes that hopefully bring to life a fascinating period that covered an all-too-brief segment of little more than a quarter of a century. In addition to many behind-the-scenes stories, I had the good fortune to meet, interview, and sometimes perform in script reenactments of some of the great shows with a lot of the talented individuals from those bygone days. Chapter 2. Durward Kirby. His first radio effort, a small one, came in 1931. The late Durward Kirby died in mid-March of 2000. Sometime before that, he provided your writer with an exclusive interview, and it was a distinct pleasure to chat with one of the all-time nice guys in broadcasting, one of those individuals who decided while in college that radio was the thing he wanted to do in life. And boy, did he do it. Later, television was his focus, and he was equally proficient there. After our delightful conversation, he sent us a picture of the first microphone he ever used on the air. It was a carbon mic, and Durward spoke his first radio words into it on February 19th, 1932 at WBAA, West Lafayette, Indiana. Back then, engineers would hit the back of such a mic with a pocket knife before a broadcast to loosen the carbon particles. His first name was often misspelled as capital D-U-R-W-O-O-D, and he was always careful to let the offenders know they were wrong. As a result...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.